Oh, ready to go again. So how's it going?
We're gradually losing people in class.
Yeah,
That's bad. And it's not yet even Friday, so no one has to go skiing yet. Okay, so today the lecture is about explaining how we actually produce an executable and what's inside to a certain degree, almost. So what it means is that we know, like, again, we take a compiler, we take a text editor, we'll open a file, we type something main and so on, and it becomes a C program. Then if you know the low-level details, you invoke a GCC or LLVM compiler or some other compiler, and something happens, right? If you don't know the details, you just press the run button and it just runs for you, so you're even more oblivious. So we're going to talk a little bit about make files, just a brief touch. In the past, I had a homework on make files. I dropped it because I thought it was too trivial. But I don't know, like, how many people understand make files? Well, how many people critically need help with make files? Okay, no, and I get it, but so come talk to me. So because I thought that it's kind of a little bit wasteful, and we'll do something more interesting. So they are not hard, and the ones which we will be using in this class will be, again, not super hard, right? So it's not about make files really, it's about how to build stuff. But what I wanted to emphasize is that when you write a make file, you're really in control. What is that you want to do? You say, look, compile this stuff into an object file. So compile my text file into an object file. And then you say, by the way, link my final executable out of those object files and maybe some libraries. But in case of operating system, you rarely can, I mean, you can structure it as a collection of libraries, but typically you just say, this is what I have. And everything what I wrote has to be compiled together. And then also linked, which means it has to run at a specific address. When it's loaded by the bootloader at address something, it has to be runnable there, which means that all the addresses within the program have to match this address at which we loaded the program, right? Otherwise, there will be some mismatch and we will crash. And that's essentially the goal of today. So we have to understand what goes into a single object file. And how multiple object files are merged together. And then on Tuesday next week, I will explain like formats of object files like ELF and AOUT, and then explain what static libraries are, what dynamic libraries are. Maybe we will spend a little bit of time on position-independent code, but most likely not. Again, in the past, I was teaching it, but I think it's too advanced for this class, and we never use it later. So it's fun topic. So, and if you're interested, you can just watch a lecture from previous year to understand how it works. Okay, so if I ask you a question, so what is that inside the program? So who can tell me? I'll be writing down.
Instructions, static data, things like that.
Well, let's be more specific. Instruction.
Yeah.
Actual machine instructions. We
Yes.
call them code on, or historically people also, man, really, we will run out of battery? Already ran out of battery. Really? So maybe not right away, but soon. Okay. I wanted to write text. So historically, the code was called text because people were typing text, right? Then you said data. So what is the data? What do you mean by that when you say data? Global variables, right? So that's a reminder from last time. Global, local, dynamic. We'll just touch on them. So global variables. And they come in two flavors. What are those flavors? Do you remember?
ESS.
Right. So ones which are zeros, uninitialized, and they go into a section which is called better safe space, and initialized ones like hello world, right? And they go into the data section. And then typically, operating system actually splits the data section in two separating read-only variables and writable variables. It's again, it helps debugging because you accidentally try to write a read-only variable, you will get an exception because you will map the page with read-only permissions or map the segment. Okay, what else do we need to run the code? Ah, surprise. You didn't expect that we need something else.
Object file.
Object file. No, that's instructions and code and text and data goes into the object file as well. This is actually object file.
The CPU.
Well, yeah. But the parts of the environment. I mean. Yeah, we need stack and heap space, right? Because, I mean, you can technically run like without them, right? But for how long you can write, you can run without a stack? Can you take a C program and run without a stack? Yes, no?
Yeah, no.
No?
Yes, no.
Okay, so who, you say no, why?
Because we first, as a C program, we have a main function. It's a function. You know, as we learned last lecture, a function needs a stack to maintain the frame, stack frame and stuff.
Right, so we need a stack to invoke functions, kind of like invoke the call instruction. But you said yes, or someone said yes. Correct. So I agree with you. So, and this is what I was trying to emphasize. It's a little bit like it goes away from the main line of the course, but there is a special compiler which can compile, and I don't know which subset of C, but maybe like a reasonably meaningful subset of C in such a manner that it doesn't use stack. It's needed for the early stages of boot. So it's the memory is not yet initialized. Caches are not yet initialized. So you can only read from read-only memory and execute program. And surprisingly, you can. There is a compiler for that. I will talk a little bit about it later. But yes, if you're clever, and it's a nice kind of like a project to develop a compiler which compiles the code which runs without stack, right? And it's possible. You say, well, instead of when I see a function, instead of a call foo, I will compile it in a sequence which does not rely on a stack. So maybe you already have some like stack frame in a data section. Maybe you can invoke foo only a couple of times or something like that. So it's less general, but it's possible. So just wanted to make sure that you can play those tricks. And of course you can run without a heap for a while, because unless you do like in the, when we will boot into main and run X with six, surprise, it doesn't have a memory allocator. There is no malloc. So whatever you want to do, you have to allocate statically, or you have to build your malloc. So guys from MIT didn't build a malloc. For simplification, like of the argument. So essentially you have a list of processes, it's really an array, and you just pick an element in this array. You say, well, does it make sense? It surprisingly does. So for example, in this operating system, which we're building right now with my students, because we're building mathematical proofs about it, building proofs about malloc is hard. So we say, okay, forget about it. There will be a very limited version of allocation. Everything else is statically allocated. So it still has an argument, right? But in general, those are the things which we need, right? I had a question somewhere. No, you don't. GoTo is like compiled to a, okay, let me ask a question. What do you think GoTo statement is compiled into?
Jumps. Jump.
And non-conditional jump. So it's just a jump, right? And of course you can like, do conditional jumps as well. Okay, cool. So we got it. So kind of a refresher. That's my slide, which essentially reiterates the same. Just again, reminder that we have those kinds of variables in C. You can come up with a language which has some other variables. I'm not like, we're not in a language class, but in C and in most typical languages, which you probably see, this is what it is. So does anyone know an example of a language which has some kind of other kind of variable? Yeah, so like, again, there are multiple types of heaps. That's an easy answer. Again, I built a couple of operating systems which have different types of heaps. They are special. Some heaps are private and can be used by only some subset of the program. And some are global for the program. And that's to essentially tolerate faults and improve isolation, meaning that if you suddenly make a mistake in a subset of a program, let's assume you have a secret key like SSH key and you want to protect it. So the crypto code is hidden from the rest of the program and it has its own private heap and stuff like that. And the program has its own private heap. And if you make a mistake in a big, large program, it still cannot access the SSH key and can only access it through a specific interface on the shared heap. And you can, like, if you think hard about it, you might come up with limitations and you say, well, I need like something else in this program. And that's fine. And of course, every thread in the program will have its own stack, right? Because you will be context switching within the same address space. The data section is the same. Global heap is the same. I mean, I said the global heap, but just let's say heap. But each thread will have its own stack, right? Because you can come back to, like, you execute it somewhere deep inside foo, maybe evoke it 10 times, context switch to another thread, ran on this stack, and then came back to the first stack, right?
So if the thread has its own stack, the stack also can share the parent stack, whether?
A question about, if I understand correctly, this is the question about fork, right? Or about what?
You said stack has its private stack, but no, you said thread has its private stack.
Right.
So I mean, yeah, but whether the thread could share the parents?
No, like, I mean, the question is probably what these threads are, right? So do we understand what threads are? Like thread create in any language. And suddenly, like, okay, let me draw you. Imagine this is your address space. You have a data section here with global variables. You have code here, and maybe you have one stack here, stack one, and you have maybe a heap. And this is how you started running. You jumped into main, so you're executing inside main. At some point, you say thread create. So at this point, like, there might be multiple constructions how you want to do it, but you say, well, I will allocate a new stack for this new thread. It will be stack two, and you will have some kind of a thread local store or some kind of metadata which maintains the instruction pointer of this thread and the stack pointer of this thread, right? And this stack pointer will be pointing here, instruction pointer will be pointing somewhere after thread create, right? And the first thread of execution returns from that thread create function, right? And it will be continuing running on this stack and will have its own EAP, right? And then either the operating system or the runtime of the language will be switching between them, right? But those two stacks will be like growing independently because like this T2 thread two and T1 here will be running in the same address space. It might not be yet very well clear. I just wanted to make sure that we have some kind of insight about what the process is. And the process is this, the entire address space, which can run multiple threads, right? And I just wanted to make sure that we understand that each thread will have its own stack. Does this argument make sense or it completely? So we'll come back to it because, it's a little hard to explain, but like, bear with me for a sec. So it's not hard. Like, it's very simple actually to begin with, but let's just not spend time on this right now. Any other questions about it? But that was your question, right? Okay, cool. Anything else? Actually, am I like unmuted on Zoom? I don't know. I hope no one is complaining. Okay, cool. Good. So what is that? I kind of made a picture of an address space. But when you create a process, when an operating system creates a process, remember, I was always drawing a bottom part of the operating system as a kernel and the upper part as a green thing. But essentially, this is the address space. So it starts from zero. Let's imagine it goes to the max address, which is 4 gigabytes on a 32-bit machine. Because if you put all ones into 32-bit register, you will end up with 4 gigabytes, right? So typically the address space is split between the kernel and the user part, right?
And so in case of x86, the split is exactly in the middle. So it's exactly at 2 gigabytes, right? And in the user part, like you really, as we said, we need the text of the process, the instructions themselves. So we need global variables in the data section. So those, like essentially this array of hello world, which is allocated in a global scope. We can organize the heap as growing this way, and this is what x86 is doing. So essentially you start with no heap, but when you do SBRK to allocate some space, you will like allocate some data here, and like you can allocate more and more. And you can set, okay, like my stack will be growing in the opposite direction, which means that until they overlap, I can grow the stack as much as I want, which is rarely done, but at some point it was like an attractive idea, but really usually stack is just limited to in x86 to one page, 4096 bytes, or in Linux, it's larger configured by the operating system, but let's say 64 kilobytes. And so here we will be allocating on the stack, we'll be allocating local variables. In this case, remember this, the second part of hello world, the world itself will be allocated as a local variable without a static attribute inside the main function, right? And this second part, the upper part of the address space, typically a operating system maps its own memory in the address space of each process. And it's not important right now, but we will see later why it's done. But the answer is to simplify invocation of system calls. So essentially the system call does not have to switch the page table, right? So you can stay on the same page table and just say, look, I am just going from privilege level 3, which is user, to privilege level 0, which is most privileged, which is kernel. Again, I will explain what these privilege levels are, but essentially this data structure, the page table, which virtualizes the address space, does not have. Again, not very important for today, but just a heads up. Any questions about the layout of the address space? Good question. And I will ask you on the exam or homework. In x86, there is a reason. In other operating systems, which are more flexible, like 32-bit version of Linux splits the address space in 3/4. So 3 gigs go to user and 1 gig goes to kernel. And the logic for that is that kernel typically doesn't need that much memory. But essentially your web browser will, like, even like 5 years ago was easily consuming 3 gigabytes, right? No, like 5 years ago is too late because it's already 64-bit machines, but let's say 10 years ago. I forget exactly when we switched. So I would say we switched roughly in like 2008, 2009 to 64-bit machines. I forgot already, right? But that's about the time when we switched. And now 64-bit address space is much larger. So again, operating system maps itself at a higher address. I forget exactly how much space it takes typically, but the user part is giant, right? But it's like in x86, there is a specific reason related to one limitation and about how they structure the address space. And that's why even if you like split it differently, you're only losing space somehow. And I will ask you later on why. You will have to understand it. Any other questions? Good. Okay, so, this is the split. And if I ask you a question, so for each of those parts, which I made a picture. Yep. Correct. Just because that's a good question. So do we share the memory of the kernel between different processes? And the typical answer, yes. There are some exotic constructions in which you have, people call it them multi-kernels, where you, I don't think there is a good name actually. So I don't think there is a standard name, but sometimes you might run two different kernels which don't share address spaces. That's very exotic. Why is that? So first of all, why do we even want to share? Like, why do we even want to share the kernel memory between address spaces? What's the insight here? Why would you do this? So let me rephrase what you said. So you say, There is some kind of like shared state, which is shared between multiple processes. And this state is kept in a kernel. Right, kind of, but just to illustrate what's going on, let's give a concrete example, which kind of explains why it's needed from our current homework. What is this shared state? One example, there are multiple of this. There is a phone. You had an aversion. You remember our example was pipe, right? So you duplicate a pipe. Pipe itself, the memory for the pipe is created here, right? But if I draw to another process on top of it, right, which will have completely different text and data and everything, right, because we exact, but they still have file descriptors. So, like, there will be two file descriptors here for process one, and there will be another for process two. And essentially, they are kind of accessible from the pipe itself has to be accessible from both address spaces, right? So, if you don't want to switch the address space, then if we map or share the memory here, the same pipe, when this guy says something like write into a pipe, you say, let's say, descriptor one, it goes into this, like his file descriptor table, and there is simply a pointer to this memory, right? And we essentially end up adding data somewhere over here inside the memory of a pipe data region, right? Temporary buffer. And then there's sometime later, there's a context switch, and we say in this process, this guy says read, and it says zero, for example, it goes to this, to his own like file descriptor table. And again, there will be just a pointer to this pipe, right? So this pipe is shared between the two processes. You can argue that file descriptors may be not shared because one process will never access the file descriptor table of another process, but the buffer of a pipe really is shared, right? That's why we share this state, it's convenient. That's how we program. Well, you can come up with a ways for how to avoid it. Like you can send a message between the kernels, kind of like in a distributed system, right? So you can emulate pipe across two different machines by just sending like TCP messages between them, right? So that's doable, but typically not needed. And so that's why we share the state. And similar, like everything is like, all the kernel state is shared. Like you said, there always some like, what I wanted to say in X86, when you say some file IO, typically not shared, but it can happen that, you know, two processes are reading the same file and X86 is actually maintaining something what is called a buffer cache. Like, you know, it caches in memory frequently accessed disk blocks, and then those disk blocks become shared between multiple processes, right? So it's convenient. So the reason we sometimes choose not to share this state is for security reasons. Like there are some like side channel attacks which allow you to learn the state of another process. And if you suddenly have something written in a secret file, you want to conceal it. So, but that's like cutting edge research today, which still doesn't have a good answer, but it can happen, but rarely, right? Okay, good. So good question. So now we understood that this yellow part is shared. It will be the same in all processes. And later on, when we construct a page table, you will understand why it's the same. It's literally in both page tables, it will be pointing to the same physical page. So if you read one address, it will be actually the same address, but you will read the same physical data on a DRAM bank.
If we're just going to talk about this later, that's fine. But does having kernel memory allocated to each process kind of distribute the kernel between processes so that there's never really a kernel process that needs to be had?
So that's a good question. Again, you can construct this differently. Like roughly speaking, in X86 there is no kernel process, but in modern operating systems there's something what is called kernel threads which never leave this yellow part. They run in a kernel. Typically, they implement functionality of handling interrupts and like implementing like device drivers. But again, it's in Linux, and I wouldn't go into these details right now. Okay. Typically, there is no kernel process. But again, at this point, it's too abstract to kind of have this discussion. I just can give you a heads up, but Let's just get very concrete about what is running where, and then it will become clear. Okay. Wait, hold on. I was actually asking a question when you ask a question. I was asking the following. So when you, these four parts, where do they come from? Like, and what I mean, like, where do they, what's the kind of the line of origin here? So this part, for example, process text, how it was created and how it ends up in memory. Right. So I just wanted to, again, to emphasize. So these two parts are, again, remember, we start from a text file or whatever, .c file. Then it goes to a compiler and linker, let's say. And then it's like saved on disk, right? And sits there as a program, right? When we execute something like exec, which is our way of creating a new runnable process, and you say something like WC, our operating system finds it on disk and loads these two parts in memory, right? From disk. Doing this step of linking, and I will use another word, relocation, like essentially making sure that the addresses inside the program match the address at which the program is loaded, right? And these two parts, like program process heap and process stack, are just simply created by the operating system, right? So they just, like, operating system says, okay, I will allocate some memory for you. And specifically, just to make sure we understand, let me again erase a little bit here too. Like if you erase here, so what is that operating system has to create on this stack? Why is it empty to begin with? Or something has to be put there?
Think it would be empty because we already know that you can use, like, something to go and use that. It's just like, okay, you can use this space.
Right. So you can say, okay, there is some garbage there, some trash. So that's okay, but for security reasons, probably operating system will actually will zero out all the pages, because what if this page was used by your SSH daemon, which put your private key into the memory? Well, not a good idea. So operating system, actually, when allocating a memory, a good operating system will zero everything out. So, but it, like, I will rephrase again, do we need anything useful in the stack, on the stack? Correct. So what you're saying is that if we are careful about it, main actually has some arguments, right? Mm-hmm. And so those arguments are put on the stack by the operating system. Otherwise, your main fail, because it will say, well, I want to access the stack, so I know that there is like EBP plus 8, right? So there will be something, right? Yeah, plus. And like, because they're above and stack rolls down, right? So, and if it might access like this yellow part, and it will crash or some unmapped memory, right? So I just wanted to make sure that we understand that even when the program starts, there will be some arguments on the stack. You mentioned environment variables. That's there too. I forget how actually environment, what's the word? And variables are implemented, right? So that's, x86 doesn't have them, so don't worry. But anyway, so we got it. So compiler and linker, these two parts, and this just from the OS kernel. Hopefully it's all zeros. So let's take a look at this example program. So again, I promised some examples, but I'm not going to compile anything today. Maybe compile something on Tuesday. But essentially, we have this tiny program, which is main, takes this canonical two arguments, so which is the number of elements in this array and the array itself. And it just simply says, okay, I will compute 5 plus 6. So you have two local variables, a equals to 5, B equals to 6, and it returns A plus B, right? So if we're going to build it, and again, for the purposes of this class, we want to build a 32-bit program just because we understand 32-bit assembly, and we will work with it. So we will use this flag, which says machine will be 32-bit, right? And I will invoke GCC compiler with this flag and say, do not generate position-independent code. And I name this file hello integer. dot C, right? And it will be there in example sections, right? So it generates something what is called an object file. And there is a special tool which allows you to read this, those object files. It's called an obj dump. And I'm working here like by default, and I forgot to, I think I mentioned it in homework one, that the, by default, the name which GCC gives to it output is a.out, right? And so that's why I say, okay, let's disassemble or obj dump a out, right? And obj dump will show you all parts of the program, right? So it will show you the text section, read-only data section, stuff like that, right? And in my example here, so I'm using, since I didn't say use the Intel assembly, it actually uses AT&T assembly. So this code, which moves ESP into EBP, right? So EBP becomes equals to ESP. So it goes this way, right? So just wanted to illustrate a couple of things here, right? So first, like when it disassembles your code, it will show you like human readable instructions, right? So this maintain the stack frame. So push EBP and move ESP into EBP, right? But it will also show you the machine instructions which are generated. And really those are the bytes which will be there sitting at the beginning of the text section. So this this is like 5589EB. It sits here. The reason I'm mentioning this is that in this class, when you will be loading some stuff into memory, you might make a mistake and you think, okay, I'm supposed to execute like push and move, but really something else is executing and I don't even know what because it's just exploding right away on the first instruction, right? So sometimes it's useful to actually dump the memory of the under your instruction pointer and see what is that really sitting there. Is that really, are those really the instructions I was supposed to execute, right? And this obj dump will show, like, I'm not saying that obj dump, they will not have obj dump, but whatever your printf of this memory region or inside GDB, you will dump the memory, you will be able to see those instructions. Okay, so, but again, like, it's very much what I was explaining last time. As I say, it maintains the stack frame because actually I probably generated the slide a couple of years ago. And today on a newer version of GCC, I have to actually say, do not omit stack frame, right? Like I was explaining, because by default, it will skip those and actually will generate code without the stack frame. But okay, in my case, I did it, right? So essentially I have the stack frame. So not surprising, right? So similar to what we had discussed last time. So here, remember I was saying, remember the program has two local variables, A and B, right? So it's two integers and it does allocate space on the stack exactly as I was explaining. So it says, okay, subtract from the stack, from the ESP register, X10. X10 is actually 16 bytes. Again, it does this stack alignment, which I was talking about. I still did not follow your link, which says, okay, it's a bug in a compiler. So I will follow it, like come back to it. But okay, it does this for real. So, and the funny part is that you can even see that this constant 16 shows up into this. This is a subtraction instruction. So it's immediate operand. So 10, right? So this X10 is really there encoded in the instruction, right? As one byte. So you can sometimes even recognize what's going on. So this is the highlight of that thing, right? So similar here. So remember those variables A and B, they have values. So they have 5 and 6. So someone has to initialize them. So the compiler generates the code which initializes the variables on a stack. They initialize them with a move instruction, right? So essentially it says, okay, please move 5 into EBP minus 8, right? That's where the space for those local variables, because EBP points right under the return address and then we subtract it. So there is a space, so it's minus, right? And again, not surprising, we will have the same constants here. So this, like you see a 5 and 6 and you even see those minuses. So like F8 here is -8 and FC is -4, right? So it's not always, you're not always lucky to like immediately see those immediate operands, but sometimes you are, right? And so like, just wanted to make sure that that's cool as well. Okay, so then we, not surprisingly, doing this, we want to do an addition, right? And remember that x86 does not allow you to add two values in memory. So you have to put at least one in register, right? So here they put both of them in register. So they, and the code is very like unoptimized. So it's like O0. So no optimizations, or maybe even no O. Like, okay, I didn't provide even O, right? Because otherwise, probably this will all be optimized out and it will be just returning whatever, 6 + 5, 11, right? So that you would like push 11 on a stack into the register EAX and return it, right? But here we just do for illustration, you will see it. So again, the same thing from EBP, moving to the two registers, EAX and EBX here, right? And not surprisingly, do an addition here. So again, x86 assembly. So the result goes this way. That's very convenient because if you leave it inside EAX, you can immediately return it, right? And that's the calling convention because you the caller expects the return value to be inside EAX register, right? And again, I mentioned that leaf is almost never happens, but in this unoptimized version of this code, we have leaf to fetch the previous stack frame and return, right? Good. Okay, now I will ask you a question. What is this? And actually for that, we will even do a poll. So I will enable activity in a sec. So actually I will leave the slide all on and well, since you still don't see my screen, which is beautiful, I will like go to my wonderful poll everywhere. And how do we do it? Doing like this active? How do I make it active? Oh, probably active now. So do you see it, guys, on poll everywhere? The question is, what is this like? They're a little small. So they're like a sequence of instructions. What do you think the answer is? What's the address? Correct. Sorry. Let me just.
Do you have the address?
Yeah, I should have put it. Today I decided not to put this poll everywhere slide on the slides, but maybe it makes sense that you can actually, just even scan it. Everyone has access to poll everywhere? Yeah, that's correct. But what do you
click it?
Yeah, cool. No, I'm just asking if everybody has it. Thank you.
Yeah, that's exchange. So you have two exchange instructions and one null. So
and how do I so everyone answered?
Yes.
Have a version. Let me just share this one with you guys. Do this. So pop. Where is my poll everywhere? Man, like it's so elusive. So people are trying to quickly, really you don't have to even show. Okay, that my attempt was to essentially just make sure that it's easier to interact with this poll everywhere, but is it? So people are thinking that we are cleaning KX register because its call is saved. setting EAX to zero to return zero. We're deallocating space on a stack and we're doing a code alignment. So who can explain us the version A? So cleaning EAX register. Yeah, go for it.
Because first, I think it should be EAX, not AX.
What did I put there? EAX. Okay, sorry, no AX, right? But maybe you're cleaning like two parts of EAX.
Okay. Yeah. So the point is, with the coding convention, we will set the caller as a return value into EAX, and then when the caller is finished, it could be the caller or callee is responsible to clean the EAX.
So. Wait. So people, do you agree with this? Like, what is this logic? So people who mark that we're cleaning EAX. Why do you think we're doing it specifically after the red instruction? What executes after this red instruction?
We come back to the
caller.
Yeah,
right.
Yeah.
So seemingly it seems that those instructions will even never execute, right? Do you agree with this?
Oh. Yes.
Because we don't have any jumps here from this code, right? So we're really just returning.
Oh.
Right?
Yes.
So then what can it be?
Code mine.
So I argue this should be code alignment. Although this is a little confusing, right? When I saw it for the first time, well, I don't know, maybe it just generated something for no reason. Or maybe it's a bug in object dump and it just shows me something, right? But I just wanted to make sure that yes, this is code alignment. And you can go ahead, resubmit your answer. But essentially, we come back to this Agnerfall. He not only wrote those tables, which tell you how many cycles each instruction takes, he also wrote some guidelines. So he has this kind of a book of optimizing low-level assembly. And he has set on good advice. I can never was really able to finish that book because every time you start reading, it gets so into the woods that I give up. But essentially, he has this good idea so that most microprocessors, including Intel, fetch the code aligned at 16 or 32 byte blocks. Essentially, remember, fetch, decode, execute. So the CPU actually does it kind of proactively, and it just fetches the entire cache line, or like on Intel, it's probably 64 byte block because the cache line is 64 bytes. And if it happens that your like code is not aligned, maybe beginning of your next function foo starts here, and you only have a couple of these bytes which you can read, right? And so you say, okay, let's not do this. Let's just pad it and just make sure that beginning of foo will be here. And then the entire cache line will be immediately available to the CPU for decode and stuff like that. So less cache misses, right? So, and GCC does it in this specific example. Again, you will not always see it. And maybe it's not, this statement is not even true on all the CPUs. But again, it's a decision which the compiler designers make. And they like measure whatever takes what, and at some point try to generate the code which is most optimal. I had a question somewhere here.
So just to make sure I understand.
Yeah, right. Yeah, exactly. So this exchange is a two byte instruction, one instruction, they padded 5 bytes. And so, which means that probably this main function is actually aligned at this 32 byte boundary or 16 byte boundary. And the next function, which will be starting here, will start at this boundary. And then when you fetch from that next label, the whole 32 bytes will be available.
In that Agnerfall quote, he recommends using a bunch of knobs. Why did GCC put some exchange instructions here instead?
It's a good question. So, and I don't know the answer why they decided that it's either equally fast or because seemingly you can put 5 knobs, it will be the same space, right? So 5, because that's what you're shooting for alignment. And maybe CPU has some shortcutting logic for executing knob, because at least this exchange operates in the register, so needs to make sure that at least one physical register on the CPU will be consumed. But I don't know, like at this point, it's up to the CPU, or maybe like if you go deep inside the GCC and we'll figure out the commit message, which you really have to trace it. And I don't know the answer. I'm sorry, like too deep. Any other questions? Say again. You didn't get why. Okay, so look, so let me erase everything. So when CPU, imagine you're returning into a function, your return instruction reads the address, and there is some address saved on a stack. And this address happens to be here. This is like the previous instruction here was a call instruction, which called this foo function, foo returns, and logically you have to continue here, right? And if this IP address happens, let's say 3 bytes away from the alignment block, the CPU, in order even to decode this instruction, maybe this first instruction, which when you return is 5-byte instruction, is actually, it's fine. It has the 3 bytes, but misses these 2 bytes. In order to get these 2 bytes, the CPU has to go to memory or the first level cache, first level instruction cache, and fetch the entire cache line, right? And so you say, whoa, hold on, I'm like waiting here a little bit. I cannot even decode an instruction because I'm missing those blocks, right? So to prevent this, they say, okay, hold on. We make sure that this happens less frequently, and the new function, I mean, my example with return is probably a little bit bogus, but imagine you are jumping to the beginning of the function, and this beginning of the function is actually in this 3 bytes. So you cannot even start executing the function because you're missing 2 out of 3 bytes of the first instruction. And so if you align everything and the beginning of the function actually starts here, then because these 2 bytes are no op and you never jump here, then you will have the whole 5 bytes available and go a little faster. That's the trick. Do you understand it? Okay, cool. Thank you. I mean, it's a good question, so I appreciate that you ask for clarification. Everyone got it? So there is this code alignment. There is a stack alignment, which I was saying due to the fact that some multimedia instructions operate on aligned values, cannot even address like a byte or cannot operate on it. And this is the code alignment for performance. Okay, cool. So now we kind of got this example. So we know what's inside the program. So like I showed you what's inside the object file, right? So logically, the goal is to load it into this memory. So there is this stack section, data section, right? So how do we get this stack? Like, how do we build them, right? So this is the bit of a make file, which make is like a language which directs the special tool, which is called make. Make is so obsolete that we probably should start throwing eggs at me right away because no one uses make anymore. So everyone uses some other build systems like CMake, whatever else, Ninja, I forgot exactly even. Never use them, but still make. So make goes like this. So it says, it specifies the goal. So in this specific example, what make is trying to do is trying to build something what is called a boot block. So it's a tiny piece of code which fits in 512 bytes of disk and BIOS, the thing which part of the firmware of the machine loads it from disk into memory and starts from there. So essentially, this is the beginning of your boot. The make allows you to specify source files. So this Go boot block depends on bootasm.c or .s and bootmain.c. So it says, okay, like we have 2 files which have to be compiled or assembled, right? And they say, okay, look, this is like my, typically it's a macro name of a C compiler macro, which expands into all the C flags. Again, I say no position independent code. And I also say no standard library. No, do not include standard libraries because they will not be around when, like in my boot block, obviously. That's the flag which says that include directory is in the same file. And it says, just please only compile the code. Do not like link it or anything. And this is the sort, bootmain.c, right? Which is this one. Similarly, for this one, for ASM, in my example, GCC can also compile assembly files. And both of these guys will actually produce, this one will produce bootmain.o which I will be using here later in the next line, and bootasm.o, right? In the next line, since these two object files were produced, I say, please link them together. And again, here I need, like, typically it's all hidden from you because you don't really care at which address the program will be linked. In my specific example, I do really care because there is a convention between the BIOS and the boot block, and the BIOS will place the boot block, which it reads from disk, into this magical address 7C00. That's why I say, okay, the code which I wrote has to be linked in such a manner that the text section starts at 7C00. Then all my local and global variables will work because they will be like at those addresses, right? And it also says that the entry function should be the start, right? And what XV6 does actually for you, for debugging purposes, for each of these object files, it says, okay, please use object dump and generate an assembly file just for you to read it. So normally you don't need it. And similarly, so for this, what it does, it also does an object copy saying that, by the way, take this boot block and only take the text section. So do not take the data section and place it in a separate file. And this file we will write into the disk of the machine to boot. And also they have a Perl script here, which checks the boot block is actually under 512 bytes because you accidentally can type a little bit more code and then it doesn't fit. And then you only have half of your boot block. Okay, so do we need to understand it? Not that much. So the illustration here is that what you do is that you take multiple C files like this and compile them into object files. And then a tool, which is called the linker, assembles them together. And this is really happening when you build your big projects with Microsoft Visual Studio, or what is it called now, Visual Studio Code. It does it underneath. It kind of hides it from you, but it does exactly the same, right? So, okay. So this process is called linking and loading, right? So let's try to understand what we are really doing here. So linking allows us to combine multiple code modules, these object files, into a single executable. So for example, you can include standard libraries into your own code, right? So someone already pre-built these object files, ship them to you as static libraries. And static libraries are just, heads up, it's just an archive, meaning that it's just an assembly of object files against which you can link. And you can link it again, them. You don't even have to build them. You don't have their source code open, right? And fine, you get one single executable file or maybe another library, right? But let's assume executable. And this is linking. And the loading is a process of essentially making sure that this executable can be loaded into the memory of machine, maybe patched with some adjustment of addresses, because maybe it was compiled to run at address zero, but the operating system really loads it at address like 1 kilobyte, because whatever, it doesn't want to use the first page of memory, right? And this requires you to kind of patch all the addresses inside the program, right? And we'll talk about it in a second. So, okay, so conceptually it looks like that. So, right? So you take a bunch of object files, maybe some shared libraries, maybe some static libraries. You have in my case, I wrote a command line to the linker saying, please link at 7C00. Linker allows you to write in a different language. You can write a linker script, which like says, okay, it takes this, take the text section, do something with it, place it somewhere else. Then you pass everything to the linker and it will generate you debug info, executable file, and the information about how to maybe load this file in memory. Essentially, it's information about what addresses inside the program has to be adjusted to be make sure that it can be run. It can run in memory. So let me just explain what it actually, like what is happening here, like at another level of details. So again, the input is a bunch of object files. Each object file will contain, roughly speaking, code and data. Those are called segments. And it will also contain a simple table which defines what symbols, like what functions essentially, and global variables are exported by by this model, making sure that other models can use them, and required to be important. So some functions, like for example, write, which writes into your like file descriptor 01, for example, in this homework which we're doing, you never implement write. So it sits in one of the libraries, right? And you just say, okay, I need it to be imported. When the program is loaded in memory, you have to pick up the, like either at the step of linking, you have to merge it with a static library, or at the time of loading, pick up a dynamic library or SO, right? Or DLL on Windows and load it in memory. And the output of it can be either an executable file or maybe another library, right? Static or dynamic. We'll talk about them next time. Okay, let's take a look at high level. Again, you have object files. Object file A calls symbols B, C, and D. Object file B, for example, uses symbols C and E. So we have an executable file. And so A provides its own symbols, B provides its own symbols, and those C, D, and E will come from somewhere else, right? So like essentially this A uses B, so B will be provided by B itself. Maybe it was object file compiled from B, and those symbols will come from libraries like C and D. And if library has some other symbols, we can actually eliminate them. So it's called like link time, link LTT, link time type optimizations, right? So kind of powerful, saying, okay, throw away the code which I'm not going to use. If I ask you a question, so why would you do this process of linking? So essentially this diagram, which is on this, like essentially you say there are some object files here, those are some libraries, .a. What's the benefit of linking?
So the programmer can just use the library instead of inputting them themselves.
The program will just use libraries.
The programmer, like I can just include some head file and use it in my program.
Correct.
I need to implement every public shell library.
Correct. So reason number one, you can reuse libraries which are built by someone else, right? They have their own build environment. As long as you follow the calling convention, you can call the function inside the library. And in order to compile the fully side code, which pushes arguments on the stack, gets the return, you can just use an include file in C, because the include file will have a signature of a function, right? So it will say it takes integer as a first argument, a pointer to a character as a second argument, and integer as a third argument. So it's like a write function, for example, right? So that's great. So you don't have to deal. So it's like essentially encapsulation, modularity, stuff like that. What are the other arguments? Smaller executable size as compared to what? You mean like this link type LT, link type LTO, link time optimization? That's actually quite advanced. So like, I don't think, okay, I agree. That's true. So you can eliminate some of the code which you don't need, right, at linking time. But what is kind of like the main, imagine you're building a Linux kernel. It takes forever to build, even on modern machines. Correct. And even in my makefile, this boot main or boot block was depending on two input files, bootasm.s and bootmain.c, right? And imagine I have thousands of those goals. So the linkers will, or this make tool will track dependencies and will only rebuild the source files or recompile the source files which have changed and then link everything together, right? That's big. Yeah, that's essentially optimization. So, and that's good because linkers for C are kind of slow, and like people came up with other, I've heard that linkers for Go are exceptionally fast, stuff like that. So like, so you can really quickly rebuild large projects, and that's important because stuff is large today. And I agree with you. So like you have those arguments. So there's this modularity argument. So program can be written as a collection of modules. And some of these are libraries, like you never heard about implementation of a write function, right? Or a printf. Printf, just think about it, like you have to parse all the possible formats and do something. So it's kind of a bit of a function. So, but they are hidden from you. And then you can quickly rebuild large pieces of code, right? So change one source file, recompile it, and relink. And if you're lucky, linking is fast enough. If you link in relinking a Linux kernel, it takes again a couple of minutes, even on big beefy machines. And also like space efficiency, right? So you can share commonly used libraries on disk. So you only need to have one version of printf if it sits inside your static library. You can like just, you don't need millions of those, right? You can just link and run. And specifically this argument works well with shared libraries because they are really, they never even like, they only load it in the address space of the process. They never even load it and merged on disk. So only when you load a program in memory, a shared library will be connected to it, right? So it sits on disk, will never be linked together. And I will illustrate this example a little later with how the sizes of the program change if you include like a standard library, for example. Okay, so and conceptually, again, conceptually it looks very, very simple. So you just say there is a bunch of this object files. I will just merge them together. And it's implemented as a two-step process. So you first scan all the input files, like figure out the boundaries of each, I say segment. So it's like those things like text and data sections. Make sure that you know, because you will be merging them. So you need to know the sizes. You collect each defined and undefined symbols. So to make sure that you like later patch everything together and know which part provides what. Again, like you need the sizes to merge them together. And then at this point, you're kind of ready to merge them together. So, and you will, like when you're doing that, since maybe your text section was sitting at address zero, but now you are merging it and something will be like another text section will be sitting on top of it, right? And you are now at address like 4 kilobyte, for example, right? So you will have to adjust those addresses. And I will explain in a second. So, but at a high level, works like that. You have three object files with, let's assume, imagine text sections here. One is 600 bytes, another is 400 bytes, another 500 bytes. We merge them literally, just merge, and it becomes one text section. No optimization, nothing like gets elided. You don't reason about whether the function is used or not. That's like kind of advanced because it's hard to reason because at this point, you sometimes even cannot decide because if you write a very obscure code, you might not be even to understand what is called, what is not, right? And like, again, if we scale it up, so we say, look, each of these had its own private text, data, and a BSS section, text, data. So we're merging the text sections, merging the data sections, and just merging the sizes of a BSS section, right? Okay, cool, we got it. So, and again, I keep saying that there is this step where we have to adjust the addresses, right, in the text section. If I ask you to guess what really needs to be, what kind of addresses need to be patched? Like just to illustrate this example, imagine you had some kind of a code which was linked to run at address zero. And now it's moved to, let's say, address X1000, which is 4 kilobytes.
Change or adjust labels.
Correct. So change labels. So remember, I was saying that if you jump to a label, maybe this label was somewhere here at address A, and now we are at address B, right? So you have to change this inside the instruction because it's already encoded. You have to change this address, right? What else? So it's not just the jump. It's obviously a call as well, right? What else? Do we need to do anything with addresses of variables?
Change
Correct. So, and what is this non-relative? What is that?
I will say a word, global, right? So what is global to your program?
First, it's the linking library. The second one I can think of is that sometimes we write a file separately and use some variable or function from another file. So
hold on. But this is like, hold on. You kind of like, you hijacked my question. So it's very simple. Imagine we have some text instructions, right? In this text section. What I'm asking is, if literally instead of, we first compile it to run at address zero, like, so this label was at address A, let's say 0x55, right? And now, since there is another text section sitting above us, this address A becomes address B, which is, let me give you a hint, will be 1055, because we added 1000 on top, right? So we just shifted it, right, in memory. And the question, okay, cool, like all instructions which we're calling or jumping to this label definitely need to be changed, right? So we got this point, right? I'm asking, what will happen to variables and what kind of variables we need to, like, imagine we are doing something like, I don't want to draw it because I will have an example in a second, just want to move a little fast. But
variables in the data or BSS.
Correct. So those global variables in the data and BSS sections, they will also be moved in memory, because again, maybe you had your own lovely data section here and suddenly it sits on top of another data section, right? And on top of like something else as well. And so you have to adjust the references to those variables as well. However, if you have a local variable on a stack, you don't have to adjust it, right? Because it's EBP-8 or whatever, right? So it's there, it will stay on the same EBP-8. If you have a variable in a heap, you will dynamically allocate it from the malloc library, so it will give you an address on a heap, right? So you don't have to do with those anything either, right? So okay, so let's take a look at this example. And the process of adjusting those addresses is called relocation. So a code is relocated to run at a different address in memory, right? So imagine here we have a snippet of code which just saves A into B, right? And again, I'm using my AT&T assembly, and it just, A is a label in memory. So it first saves it inside EBX register, EAX register, and then from EAX back into B, right? So we know that A is defined at this in the same file at address 1234. And B is extern, so it has to be imported. We don't really know what it is, we just know the type. Let's say it's integer, or the same time as B, as A. So the compiler will generate the following sequence, right? So again, 1 byte opcode, and then 4 bytes of headers. And you see that the address is written in some funky manner, which is backwards, right? And that's your introduction to this endianness, right? So there are machines which save addresses in different formats. So I have a tiny thing here. So addresses are increasing this way. And so it's A, the value is A, B, C, D, right? And on one machine, which is called a little endian machine, they are written backwards. So D comes first. And in our example, 3, 4 comes first. The upper bits, which are zeros, the upper bytes will be here, right? So we're on a little endian machine. On another machine, which is a big endian, like A will come first, right? So just don't get surprised. So just make sure that you look at the disassembly, you get it, okay? Like, yeah, that's my variable, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, cool. So the compiler generated this code because it knows the address when was compiling this code, right? So essentially the code, which this is an assignment in C, right? And for the B variable, it just didn't know anything about it because it's not really known where it is sitting. So it just puts zeros there for now, right? And leaves it in an object file like that. So that's fine. But when we do this step of relocation, or essentially, like I provided in my make file, 7C00, but assume that someone provided a different value and A is relocated by 10,000 bytes in hex, and B is found at address this, for example. This is how the linker, which does the relocation, needs to change your code. It has to add this x10000 to your original address, which is because it's shifted by that value, 1234. And that's why this 01 shows up here, because the result is 1x11234, right? And this one is sitting in the bit here, right? And since we now know the address of B, we just have to patch and make sure that this is the address of B in this instruction, right? At a high level, simple, right? Let's take a look at a more advanced example. Any questions about it? Right, so again, relocation is kind of simple. So it's kind of a linear shift, right? So that's why it's kind of not super hard. So we adjusted it. Okay, more realistic example. So here we have a source file, m.c, which has a main function. Main function defines a global variable hello world as a string and calls an a function, passing this string as an argument. The a function itself is not defined in this. And instead of using an include file, I just, in C, you can write this external void a with arguments, essentially signature of a function. So the compiler knows how to generate the call site. Essentially, we'll just push address of a on the stack, right? And then we'll do something like call of address of a, right? But obviously it will not know the address of a yet, right? And the second file is a.c, implements a, so, and implements whatever. It just simply writes to the standard output, the string, just computing its length, right? Agree? So I explain the extern, I explain the write. Again, so if we compile this main function, you will get the following object file. So it will have two sections, text and data. So an A object will, like, essentially says, I will print you out all the sections which I see in this file, object dump. So one will be a text section. It starts at address 0 and has a size of hex 10, which is 16 bytes, right? And if you carefully count those hello world bytes, you'll end up with 16. So it's allocated space for hello world. And inside the data section, which says, okay, look, I will start it right away on top of the text section, right? So it also, by the way, has 16 bytes. So it so happens that this function fits in 16 bytes, purely coincidence, right? Okay, so like we have this, starts at 0, starts at 16 bytes. If you like remember, the text section starts at 0, so not surprisingly, the entry point of the like main function is disassembles at address 0, right? Like we have this, like again, like what I was, my question here probably should be, what things need to be relocated in this code if I show it to you? Like imagine we have this slide. Which ones are correct? So like when you're passing the address of a string inside the function, when you generate this push instruction, which uses the address of the string, this address you will need to relocate, right? Because it will change. Good. What else?
Where to jump? A.
A, exactly. Yeah. Because A is nowhere around. So the next instruction here, which will be a call of A, doesn't know the address of A either, right? At this point. And this is exactly what the compiler generates. So, right? So, by the way, it gives you a hint. So when you invoke an object dump, which will actually tell you that this is the relocation entry, and it will give you even a name. So this is a relocation for A. Let me explain what it means. So here we say, look, the instruction which pushes the string sits in a data section at address x10. So because the data section starts here, right, at x10, and But by the way, just remember that this address will have to be relocated when we merge the binary later, right? Not surprising, right? And the second relocation, so this is like for calling the string. And the second relocation entry will be the call of A itself, because we actually don't know the address of A, and the compiler puts this unusual address here, right? So it says, okay, call a function, it will disassemble as called zero, right? Why is it called zero here?
I don't know. We don't know the IP address.
No, like I will ask it differently. Why are we using this F3, FF, FF, FF? Good point for a poll, but we don't have time. Almost, like good guess. So this funky address, which translates to FFFFF3, is really minus 13, because it's like the one complement of, that's how you compute the negative addresses, right? And it actually does jump 13 addresses backwards. There is an addressing mode in x86, which says, okay, instead of jumping to an address, you can jump relative to the EAP instruction pointer. So if you count, like this instruction starts at byte 8 and it ends at byte 13, I guess. So essentially 8 plus 5 is 13, and you're jumping back 13, you're really landing on the entry point of a program. That's done. I mean, it's kind of a preventive measure that if you somehow screw up your relocation step, instead of like jumping somewhere randomly, you jump to the entry point. Will it help you? Not so sure. Sometimes newer compiler will just be jumping around, essentially saying, okay, if you land here and the symbol is not relocated, just jump to the beginning of the same function. And you will be like looping until you run out of the stack space by pushing return address, right? So at least it might help you to debug the problem. Sometimes it happens. You somehow failed, didn't figure out that this symbol has to be relocated. So you will be jumping in loops, right? Okay, got it. So these two, the string and the A, have to be relocated. So let's stop here. We'll come back next week. We'll finish this example. We'll take a look at what code is generated for this write part and stuff like that. We'll go from there.
That's the slide.